благодарности вашу посылку. И до... Не понимаю. Я была бесконечно тронута вашим вниманием и заботой. Только больше нам не посылайте. Все тоже тяжело... А вы тоже тяжело работаете, а нам слава получше, не понимаю, живется. Мы имеем, что нужно. Если когда-либо на какой-нибудь нас вспомнить, то можете поблагодарить лишь Карем. Моя Гиминаючи, Норс, Иран. Не. Вы принесли нам обоим большую пользу. Витамины.
Вы подвинулись.
Имел сильное головокружение. И ему очень помогло. Сима, я вот опять болела. Сильные желез под мышкой. Мне нужен пенициллин. Он идет только срок действия. Сам на каждой бутылке будет имеется и до 50-го года. Для Симы это тоже очень большая польза будет. Мне нужен несколько регулярных ударов витамина сделать, чтобы уничтожить эту сильную инфекцию. Недавно знакомая получила и вылечилась. Я думаю, это можно упаковать вместе с кофе. Что касается ваших посылок, то я сожалею, ничего не могу сказать. Теперь получили посылки, которые оплатили пошлину. Ясно. Так.
certificates are registering. Whoever can do so hides. The word Melina has become relevant. To hide, to bury oneself in a basement, in an attic, to save one's life. The tenants of a house go into a hideout. We go with them. Three floors of warehouses in the courtyard of Shevlov 4. Stairs lead from one story to the other. The stairs from the first to the second story have been taken down and the opening has been closed up with boards. The hideout consists of two small warehouses. You enter the hideout through a hole in the wall of an apartment which borders on the uppermost story of the hideout. The hole is blocked ingeniously by a kitchen cupboard. One wall of the cupboard serves at the same time as a little gate for the hole. The hole is barricaded by stones. The flat through which you enter the hideout is located near our apartment. Little groups of people with bundles go in. Soon we also crawl through the hole of the hideout. Many people have gathered in the two stories of the hideout. They sneak along like shadows by candlelight around the cold dark cellar walls. Everyone begins to settle down in the corners of the stairs. Pillars and bundles are spread out on the hard bricks and boards and people fall asleep. The candlelights begin to die out. Everything is covered in darkness. You hear only the snoring of the sleepers, a groaning, a restless murmuring. It is stifling, an odor of a cellar and of people crowded together. From time to time, someone lights a match. By the light, I see people lying on the bricks, like rags on the dirt. I think, into what kind of helpless, broken creature can man be transformed? I'm at my wit's end. I begin to feel very nauseated. The people are crawling out. Persons with yellow certificates are streaming to the gate. How I envy them. I met my friend. He's pale, has not had enough sleep. We're in the hideout again. While lying thus on bundles, I fell asleep. A noise, the sound of people crowding each other, woke me up. I understood that the Lithuanians were already in the ghetto. The hideout is becoming fuller and fuller. People mass together. Everything becomes completely enveloped in a black, dreadful silence. My heart beats as tough with hammers to the cadence of the storm outside. Soon I feel that the storm is approaching us. My head is dizzy. A cold perspiration oozes forth. My heart stops beating entirely. Broken locks snap, doors creak, axes, saws. I feel the enemy under boards on which I am standing. The light of an electric bulb seeps through the cracks. They pounce, teeth break. Soon the attack is heard from another side. Soon, somewhere upstairs, a child bursts into tears. A desperate groan breaks forth from everyone's lips. We are lost. A desperate attempt to shove sugar into the child's mouth is of no avail. They stop off the child's mouth with pillows. The mother of the child is weeping. People shout in wild terror that the child should be strangled. The child is shouting more loudly. The Lithuanians are pounding more strongly against the walls. However, slowly everything calms down on itself. We creep out of the hideout after a six-hour imprisonment. It is 8 o'clock in the evening. Everything resembles the aftermath of a catastrophe. The tenants' belongings are scattered over the courtyard. Smashed locks lie around under our feet. Everything is turned upside down, topsy-turvy, broken. It is dark. The street is full of the tragedy which has just happened here.
Dale.
Hola, ¿qué tal? Estamos acá en Riga, la capital de Letonia, para contarles la historia del gato negro, de la casa del gato negro. En esta casa vivía un comerciante al que no lo dejaban ingresar al gremio de los comerciantes. Entonces, para vengarse, puso dos gatos negros con la cola apuntada hacia el edificio del gremio. Cuando llegó un acuerdo en el juzgado, dio vuelta a los gatos para que la cola apunte hacia el lado contrario y así arregló el diferendo. Espero que les haya gustado la historia. Chao.
Dale.
Hola, un saludo de Guillermo Blucherman desde Riga, la capital de Letonia, para contarles la historia de la casa del gato negro. Cuenta la leyenda que en esta casa que se ve acá atrás, de estilo Art Nouveau, vivía un comerciante al cual no dejaban ingresar al edificio de enfrente, que era el gremio de los comerciantes. Entonces puso en el tejado de su casa dos gatos con la cola apuntando hacia el gremio. Cuando el gremio se quejó, fueron a un juicio y finalmente, cuando lo aceptaron, él pactó que daba vuelta a los gatos y la cola apuntaba hacia el otro lado. Espero les haya gustado esta anécdota. Saludos.